2020 or STIP 2020. We're very glad to have with us here a stellar panel and an enthusiastic audience who is registered for the event and is watching us live on YouTube. I am Spurti Raman from Gubi Labs, and I will be one of the moderators today. And with me is Dr. Smita Jain, Executive Director at India Bioscience, who will steer the panel discussion. Smita, welcome.
Thank you.
So I'm very pleased to introduce our panelists today. We have Professor Gagandeep Kang, who needs no introduction probably. She's the Executive Director of the Translational Health Science and Technology Institute at Faridabad. So welcome, Professor Kang. We are very glad to have you with us today.
Thank you, Spurti. I'm very happy to be here.
Thank you, Professor Kang. Our next panelist is Professor Sher Ali. He's the Director, Center for Interdisciplinary Research in Basic Sciences, Jamia Millia Islamia. Welcome, Professor Ali, to this discussion.
Thank you.
Up next, we have Professor Vivek Kumar Singh from the Department of Computer Science, Banaras Hindu University. Welcome, Professor Singh.
Thank you, Spurti. Thank you.
And then we also have Dr. Bhakti Dongonkar, a postdoctoral researcher at NCBS, National Center for Biological Sciences, Bengaluru, joining us today to provide her perspectives on the country's R&D ecosystem. Welcome, Bhakti.
Hi.
And then we are very sorry that Professor Abhinandan could not make it to the event today due to a personal emergency. Although we would miss his inputs, I'm sure we're all looking forward to a great discussion today with all the other panelists. So with that said, before we start with the session, I would like to invite Dr. Chagun Basha from the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India to provide his comments on the drafting process of India's Science, Technology and Innovation Policy 2020 or STIP 2020. And how inputs from the panel discussions that we are having today and those to be followed would feed into the drafting process. Chagun, over to you.
Thanks so much, Spurti. I excuse myself for having this informal attire. I'm really glad to be making this remark where people like Professor Sher Ali, Professor Kang, and Professor Vivek Singh and Bhakti and all others are there in this panel. And thanks. To Smita and you for taking lead in this panel, and I'm sure this is going to be one of the interesting discussions that we are having in this panel series. Talking about this, I just wanted to jump in here to give some background about this thematic panel series from the STIP 2020 Secretariat side of it. The STIP Science Technology Innovation Policy 2020, the process started 2 months back and we are in the midway now. And many of the panelists here are the members of the thematic group, the drafting process as well. So this panel is one way for us to connect to the extended pool of experts and the public into the drafting process of the policy. So ideally, this is how we are making it more participatory, not only limited to the close group of experts who are in the track two process of the STIP 2020 policy. And with that remark, I would like to welcome all the esteemed panelists and the participants and members who are being at the audience part of it also through YouTube and various social media platforms. I request our audience to not only post questions and comments, but also to come up with ideas and suggestions what they would like to see, because this is one way that we would feature their voices into the policy making process. With that, I hand it over to Spurti. Please take it.
Thank you, Chagun. Thank you for those introductory remarks. Well, I just wanted to give a sense of what we have in store for today. Today's event is going to be divided into two parts. In the first part, we will have the panel discussion for about 45 minutes to an hour based on how it goes. And the second part involves participation from our viewers where they can ask questions to the panelists. Viewers, you don't have to wait until the end of the panel discussion. If you have a burning question, please shoot it out. And the question answer session is going to be about 45 minutes or an hour based on how we time it. Okay, and with that, again, thank you all, the panelists, the viewers, and the team behind this for joining us this evening. We're definitely looking forward to have a great set of questions coming from our audience to the panelists. On YouTube, if you are watching us, please type your questions in the comment box. And if you are on other platforms like Twitter or Facebook, please add the hashtag AskStip2020RND to ask your questions so that it's easy for us to filter it out. Feel free to add your name and place if you are comfortable. So that gives us a sense to know where you are coming from. Please do keep the questions crisp, relevant, and short, and refrain from adding your contact details because we won't be contacting you through this. In case you need a detailed discussion, the discussion forum on the Science Policy Forum's website is a better and more engaging platform for you to put in your thoughts. Now, without much delay, I request Smita to get started with the panel discussion.
Thank you so much, Spurti. I'm audible, right?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay. Good evening, all, for joining today's much-awaited panel discussion. And I would like to thank the organizers of STIP 2020 for giving me this opportunity to steer the panel discussion this evening on R&D ecosystem in India with the galaxy of stars as our panelists today. Each one of them, as were introduced, come from very different backgrounds with huge experience in their and understanding of this much larger R&D ecosystem. And I'm sure you all would agree that never before the world has looked up to the scientific community for solutions as they are looking today, thanks to COVID pandemic. So this is the time to bring in the right changes in order to stay basically true to the public sentiments. And as Chagun said, each voice matters. Healthy and fruitful discussion to understand the various different perspectives of our panelists. And the key points that would emerge from today's discussions will be helpful in putting this whole policy together. So with that, I guess we are ready to move to the question answer session. Right, Spoon?
Yes. So Smita, yes, thanks for setting the context in for the panel discussion now. With that, yes, we will get started with the panel discussion right away, and you are free to shoot the first question.
Okay, thanks. So Dr. Khan, this first question is for you. And maybe before I start, I would request all the panelists to kind of keep their answers crisp and maybe within three and a half minutes each, not more than that, because I'm sure we will also get lots of questions from the audience as well. So a lot has been said about leadership, and I guess our first question is geared towards leadership, but how can leadership encourage building a competitive and a collaborative R&D ecosystem and promote ease of doing science in India? Dr. Khan.
Thank you for that question, Smita. I think one of the things that has become evident in the last 20 years or so is that if you want to do big science, you can't do it alone. The days of having huge discoveries made by one scientist toiling alone for many, many years seem to be receding. Those kinds of events are quite rare, particularly in biology. In one way to think about it might be to say that that kind of science largely has been done, and now new discovery requires such diverse skill sets that you need to work with the best collaborators in the field to get new insights. So therefore, one of the roles of leadership is to ensure that people understand that science and its applications require expertise in a number of different fields. And if you want to achieve something big, the best way to do that is to work together. There is this African proverb that I've used, which essentially says that if you want to go far, you should go together. And if you really want to deliver on something, I think collaboration and partnerships are really key to seeing a project all the way through to its finish. And that's becoming very evident in these days with COVID science requiring expertise from multiple areas.
Wonderful. Dr. Ali, would you want to add to that your own thoughts?
So Smita, I think Professor Ali is having some issues on his side. He says we are not audible. So okay. I will sort that out. Maybe he should just, you know, have, you know,
the
you can go on
okay.
your panel.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Dr. Vivek, would you want to add here in terms of, you know, leadership encouraging building this competitive, collaborative R&D ecosystem?
Well, yes. Thank you, Smita. In fact, as Dr. Khan said, it's very important that we have the right kind of environment in place in, you know, all kind of institutions. So if we look at the R&D ecosystem in India, it's quite diverse. We have diverse kind of institutions. We have research and development activities going on in universities. We have, you know, different government labs. We have industrial research and development wings. So all these institutions and the kind of settings that we have at different places, they vary a lot.
And now it comes.
Each of them have their own challenges and their own problems, and you know, the settings in which all these institutions operate, they all need different kind of leadership and they all need different kind of collaborative working. So this kind of collaborative, and particularly this is very important for India, because you know, the kind of diverse setting that we have, unless we have the right kind of leadership where everybody from top to bottom is aligned with the same goal, it's going to be huge problem for, you know, coherence in the organization. And that is something that is quite visible in India, and a lot needs to be done. And I would not hesitate to say that perhaps the top leadership of institutions should also be made accountable to a large extent. And that is how, once the top leadership is accountable, the entire system will work in tandem in the same line.
Perfect. OK. So basically, the right environment in order to bring this diverse setting in a collaborative mode is what I gather. Great. So moving on, I guess leadership is definitely key. So let's move on. To understand, maybe Dr. Ali, if you can answer this question. I guess we have Dr. Ali back on the.
Yes, we do.
Okay. Okay. So, what is? I just want to understand the status quo in today's R&D ecosystem in India, in terms of the overall output that we have, and also maybe a comment on the infrastructure that we have, and. So basically the output infrastructure and the efforts that are needed to enhance this further.
Many of the points that were made, I could not hear. I restarted the system and now I am okay. So just to share with you what I did not hear, I cannot react. But the question about leadership, I would make a couple of comments. One. What Vivek has said is very true. Leadership is something that people are appointed as director or vice chancellor. But often the rules are broken. And everybody is equal, but somebody is more equal. So we cannot fix this problem because there is a political interference also. And we don't have to say many things can be understood.
Okay.
Now comes the point.
So
there is an echo that I see. If the echo can be stopped, then perhaps I can communicate in a better manner. Okay. So the next point is how much leaders have played the role as a mentor, both for faculty as well as for the students.
I guess, Dr. Ali, we have a question on mentorship a little later. I mean, we can get on to mentorship
yeah,
little
I'm
later.
Yeah.
No, but I want to know from you, I want to know from you the status quo on the India's R&D output versus the infrastructure that we have.
Very few institutions can brag about the adequate infrastructures. They are premier institutions of the country. And of course, government has indeed spent a lot of money for that. But there is a lot of heterogeneity across the country. And this heterogeneity has resulted in so-called not up to the mark infrastructure or poor infrastructure, which has resulted no work or very shoddy work because people have given up. And this is unfortunate because talent and infrastructure both go together to be able to do science and then keep on moving towards the so-called cutting edge. But cutting edge science cannot be done without infrastructure. So this is something where we have to think in terms of bringing this sea change across the country. I am aware of the fact that we have 137 crores of people. It's not easy. It is not easy more so when state government hardly chip in or takes any interest. And these are the real difficulties. Look at the state universities in many parts of the country. Look at the quality of teacher, quality of scientist. I'm sorry to say this, but I'll go with this. I was an examiner in MSc examination. Polymerase chain reaction photograph from the book was copied and distributed to the student. And that was practical examination. You can very well imagine the level of teaching. So everything, as I said, goes together to be able for us to impart the high quality education. And obviously the responsibility lies in the hand of the leader.
So the leadership, leadership plays a key role there as well. Spurti, over to you.
Yeah, so I have another question related to, how India can do better. We did obviously talk about the status quo. So according to a 2018 report, India has about 250 researchers per million population, which is considerably low when compared to countries like China, UK, and the US. So with the goal that we want to do big science here, how do you think we can enhance our institutional capacity and capabilities in STI research? So when I say STI, I'm talking about science, technology, and innovation research across the academic institutions to take up this challenge where we want to increase the number of researchers and match up to countries like China or the UK or the US. So this question, Bhakti, can you provide your inputs on this?
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Infrastructure-wise, I would say, and leadership-wise, since that was the ongoing theme. I feel researchers in their early careers, if they have collaborative projects, as Dr. Kang said, the institute leadership needs to open up and not constrain the early career researchers from collaborating. I know they lack experience at that stage, but they have the energy, they have the enthusiasm. And so if they can build a team early on and find ways to, navigate in a collaborative team and bring new ideas together, although it's new, it hasn't been experienced before, and therefore a lot of the PIs at a higher level are anxious about, volunteering to supervise or to help you out in different ways. But I feel some sort of independence needs to be given by the leadership to researchers early in their career to explore these possibilities, if they are possible or not. And not necessarily, it doesn't necessarily have to result in a positive outcome, but maybe in the process they learn to network, build those contacts, and then in the future, the same collaborations might just fall into place.
Yeah, I think you're definitely referring to a great point about, you know, having the ability to take on challenges, whether something works or not. That's an important, you know, onus to be, you know, having accountable, having our leadership people, you know, being accountable for this. So on that note, Professor Kang, do you want to add on to this? On how you think India can really match up to countries like the US, UK, or you know, or China to really improve our research output as well as the number of researchers who are practicing pure science?
I think Bhakti made some really important points, and it is the responsibility of leadership to get out of the way of younger people, to support them, but also make sure that we don't stand in their way in any shape or form. That can sometimes be quite difficult to do because you think with your world of experience, you might actually know better than the younger person. But if you don't give people, while you offer support, you also need people to grow in their own ways. So if you don't let them find their way for themselves, you know, occasionally making a mistake and recovering from it, you need to be there to support them when they falter. When they're flying, let them go. So I think that's the only way to look at building the number and the enthusiasm for research. If you create a top-down kind of structure, where people struggle to move ahead, it does not build ambition. It does not allow young people to take on ambitious projects, want to do better and bigger things. And where collaboration is concerned, the more you bring young people together, what you're doing is building the future. They're going to work with each other for the next 10, 20, 30 years. That's something that we absolutely should be promoting. Collaborations in India, but international collaborations as well, because benchmarking yourself within India, you know, a few institutes, you will always do better than the bulk of the rest of India, because you have facilities, access, peers that others don't have. The real question is, where do you figure on the international stage? And if you really want to be able to deliver, that should be the benchmark we should be using.
Thanks for those inputs, Professor Kang. Just a request, is it possible for you to turn on your video so that it's going to be more interactive, so to say, and people can see you? If it is possible from your end.
I just turned it on.
Thank you so much. Yes, we can see you. So with that, I think it was great that you brought out on, you know, you really mentioned something that is really relevant to probably and resonates with a lot of young researchers to say that, okay, leadership should really get out of the business when people are really flying. So with that note, I would pass on to Smita.
Smita, you're on mute.
So just if you can add one more point, this was regarding, you know, letting people fly, but also in terms of increasing the number of researchers that we have. What are your thoughts there? Do we have sufficient number? Definitely not. And what can be done to kind of increase the overall capability in terms of number?
So one of the things to think about is that we actually count people who are in universities as researchers, though the bulk of their responsibility is teaching and not necessarily the kind of high quality research that we would like to do. If we think about higher education and research in general, the idea that all research happens, or high quality research happens in government institutions, is becoming more and more inaccurate. There is a lot of good research that is being done outside of government institutions, and maybe in a way we have failed our universities by taking the best research, taking the best resources, and parking it in institutions. You know, whether it is National Institute of this or a limited number of IITs or ISERs, what we've essentially done is decided that we are going to focus the bulk of our resources on a small number of people. And the idea of now having central universities in every state is an attempt to counter that approach.
Right.
What I'd really like to see is a focus on making sure that industry interacts with the government institutions, which happens already, but also with universities. Now, there have been university accelerators. Those tend to be more technology focused. I'd like to see a focus on what could be considered more upstream basic research, as well as the more downstream application of research that industry is interested in.
Right. So I guess when we are talking of the number, when we are talking of the overall number, this would like maybe Dr. Vivek here to shed light on this point that I'm going to just state. So we as a country are third in number of PhDs that we are producing, third in number of PhDs, but really low in the total number of researchers that we have. How do we understand this imbalance and what can be done? Dr. Vivek.
Yeah, well, Smita, a very important point, and you know, there are a lot of things that we have to look at when we look at data. And unfortunately, what is happening in India is when we look at the research and development data, we largely focus ourselves on the output side. We only look at, you know, what is the total number of publications that we produce as a country? What is the total number of patents? What is the total number of PhDs that we produce? But I think what we need to see is also the other parts of that. You know, we have to look in a holistic manner where we look at the input side. What is the investment that we do in science? What is the overall ecosystem that is doing science? Where are the resources for doing science coming into? So if, you know, based on the numbers that you said, if we look at some data, for example, we know by many reports, some of them are commissioned by Department of Science and Technology, that we are now number 5 in terms of the total, you know, scientific research output. You take it by Scopus. If you take it by Web of Science, it could be like 8 or 9. So we are at least, you know, close to between 5 to 10 by different databases. If we look at the global share, we are somewhere close to 4 to 5% of the total research output of the world is coming from India. But what I would say is, if you look into account what Spurti said, you know, 250 people per million. So you're counting about 250 FTE. The output that we produce with such a low FTE, I think it's good. I would never say, you know, that we're not productive in that sense. But of course, you know, at the same time, it is equally important to be producing quality output.
Exactly.
This is where, you know, we need to work on, because if you look at citation wise, well, you know, only about 4% of the global citations are to the research output produced from India. So given the fact that we are producing at least 5 to 6% of total research output, should have been better. If you look at, you know, the top 1% most cited research output in the world, we are somewhere close to 2.7 to 2.8% of the share that we contribute. So the basic point that I want to make here is that if we have to take, you know, if we have to really expand in terms of the research output, the outputs of all kinds, research papers, patents, products, innovative products, we really need to expand our R&D system. And when we say we really need to expand, it can't be limited only to universities. As Dr. Khan, you know, wonderfully said, we have to reach beyond the elite institutions. It can't be only ISERs and IITs. We are a country with 900 universities, 35,000 colleges, but look at the status of many state universities, many colleges. The basic infrastructure is missing. Forget about research. And a bulk of the work that teachers do is essentially teaching, and this very limited amount of time for research. So I think, you know,
right.
this expansion has to be in a holistic manner.
Right, right. So taking in from there, can we also discuss about promoting research culture and capabilities in tier two and tier three cities? Because mostly we, I guess, if whenever the discussion happening, we talk of the elite institutions or few universities. But if we want to develop this more holistically, I guess the research institutions in tier two and tier three cities also have to be integrated with the mainstream R&D ecosystem of the country. So what are the views of the panel? Maybe Dr. Ali, if you want to take this first, and Vivek, you can add to it. Dr. Ali? I'm not sure if we have him.
Oh, we do, but he's on mute.
Am I audible now?
Yes, okay, Professor Ali, go on.
See, Smita, it's a good point. I would ask a simple question to all of us. How much science has become attractive today? Are the students feel motivated the extent to which we would like them to be? That's one point. Second point is that basic education in far-flung areas in the country is the state subject. And I was given to believe that unless state governments take this seriously and creates a kind of environment where students are motivated and enthused and they are able to see science as a very attractive option, they would not run and go and become, you know, IAS and IPS, run to UPSC. This is right from the beginning, at the very early stage, that we need to initiate and baptize them for science. That's one point. Second point is that I have seen with my own eyes in several universities in the country, this situation is really pathetic. And nobody is responsible for this, or everybody is responsible for this. We have to account for that also. Number three, the funding is not always proportionate to the so-called output of the student, PhD student, or scholars, and so on and so forth. It has to be taken care of very carefully. And last but not least, as it has been rightly said, we have to come out from our preconceived notion that great science can only be done in so-called premier institution and universities cannot produce good science. That's not true. Harvesting the local talent, encouraging them and promoting them and constantly encouraging them is something which will go a long way to fulfill our so-called dream that we have to do. And if you pose a specific question, I will be very focused to answer that question. Over to Spurti.
So, Dr. Vivek, would you also want to add here in terms of promoting tier, you know, research infrastructure and output in tier two, tier three cities?
I think I just have a very small point to add. When we talk about, you know, doing research and producing, you know, ideas, products which could be useful for the society, one thing is very, very important, and that is where we talk about resources for doing science. Now, if we have to expand our R&D system, we really need resources, resources like anything. If we look at the investment that we have, so, you know, the broad measure, we say GER, the gross expenditure on research and development, we are somewhere close to 0.7% of our GDP at the moment. Now, if you compare it with other countries, well, you know, United States, close to 3%. If we talk about China, is 2%, and don't forget the size of economies that US and China has. So the absolute amount of money that goes into R&D in these countries is many, many times higher as compared to what we do in India. So if we have to expand, we have to gather resources. Now, I'm sure, you know, this resources, the public fund cannot cater to all these resources. So we have to find out ways to attract resources from private sector, possibly from philanthropic organizations, perhaps, you know, some kind of extraordinary incentive mechanisms could be created for private sector companies to fund research. And something has already started as part of the CSR initiative. So in order to expand, we need resources. And once we have the resources, this could be used to create the infrastructure. And once we have it, of course, you know, then the other point comes is ease of doing science that we can talk of later.
Yes, that's Spurti.
Yes, so the other thing, I think Dr. Vivek just set some context to my next question. So this, I would like to have Professor Kang's input start off with. The question is about how do we then develop a strategy to promote extensive research, innovation, industrial collaboration, and everything that needs to go on hand in hand to establish India as the as an international R&D hub, so to say. So Professor Kang, do you see some points out there?
Sure. I mean, you know, it, generically, this all sounds very good. But do we have the capacity, the absorptive capacity to take on projects like this? And if we do, what are the areas that we should be thinking about? The best way to do this is, in my opinion, and I'm sure people will differ, is to define the areas that really matter to us and make sure that we have a limited number of areas where we decide that in a finite time, we are going to make a difference. We are going to throw everything we have at a problem and do our very best to solve it. We are, as Vivek said, not the richest country in the world, but we have lots of very bright minds. And if we decide that we are going to focus on something, I think we can do it. You know, one of the things about India that strikes me as being very different from the rest of the world is the idea of scientific temper. I know that a lot of people say, you know, that's just a phrase that has been used for a very long time. But if I think about my upbringing, if I think about my students, I think about people that I encounter, the communities that I work with, there is no aversion to science. Okay. Unlike many parts of the world, science is something that is viewed as being valuable, as something to aspire to. You do science as a preferred option. You kind of go to humanities if you are not good enough for science, right? That sets us apart from the rest of the world, and we need to recognize that. We need to capitalize on it. As I said, focusing on a limited number of areas is probably our best way of starting. And then success feeds on success. If we can do some things well, I think we will only have more enthusiasm to amplify programs that are similarly structured to be ambitious.
That's a very, very interesting point you've made, Kang, that, you know, as a community, we are not averse to science, and that's what we can leverage to go further. Dr. Ali, would you want to add to that question that we Spurti had asked? I guess there's some issue with internet, so Spurti is off.
Yeah, can you hear me, please?
Yes, okay, we can.
I think I'm happy we are all on the same page, almost on the same page. You see, in any organization, whether it is a so-called premier institution or university setup, let us ask a question. Do we induct the right kind of faculty member that they are sensitive to the areas that they are supposed to perform? Do they have sufficient domain knowledge? Are they able to inspire the students? Will they be able to deal with the student taking care of the local dynamics, students' background, their financial condition, emotional conditions, and so on and so forth? Now, why am I saying this? Is because eventually everything is related. If in an institution, teachers are smart, students are bound to be smart. And if students are smart, teachers have to work hard to be able to ensure that they are able to justify their presence in the campus. We have not been able to induct in the university system, also in some of the institution I personally know, very bright people, they are rejected. Who is responsible for that? Somebody has to be responsible for that also, which we hardly ever think. Then there is a terminology that we use for induction of the faculty member or even for a student. There is something called taking local dynamics into consideration. This is not a local dynamics. This is only our bias attitude, preconceived notion, and touch me not attitude that we have to dislodge. Unfortunately, India is a great country, and India is one of the richest country in the world where lot of poor people live. This is not my original sentence. I got it from someone, and I'm quoting, India is one of the richest country where lot of poor people live. So we can change this situation if we start inducting people, students, faculty members, even director, vice chancellor, purely on the basis of merit. Things will start happening in a big way. Let me also remind you, science is also linked with the university and vice versa. Look at the quality of vice chancellor. They cannot speak about the domain that they claim to be having knowledge, even for 15 minutes. Forget about their track record and so on and so forth. Why? Because we have constant and continuous interference from one corner or the other corner, and then it has reduced the whole thing to something which I would say just stop here and I leave it to your imagination. We, however, have to take very serious note of what is happening around us. It's a country where we must enjoy our democratic right, and only thing that we should take into consideration is merit, merit, and merit. That's all. Over to Smita Jain, please.
Well, I guess you've touched upon a really sensitive but one critical point that affects our overall R&D output, as I would say. So maybe Dr. Kang, the next question I'm going to ask you, and Bhakti, if you can also add to it after Dr. Kang is done. Do you think this nepotism and inbreeding during recruitment process is the devil as well? Because when Dr. Ali was talking of merit, I thought I would also ask this question, because this has come from Professor Amita Bandyopadhyay from IIT Kanpur. And we just thought we'll ask this question right here when we are talking of this issue. Dr. Kang?
Well, it's obvious to anyone who works in academia that there is an old boys network. So it's not just a question of recruiting people that you know that come from backgrounds that you are familiar with. It is something that persists through and the entire career of a researcher. And this is not limited to India. It happens in many other places in the world. Where we probably differ a bit is that we tend to pay lip service to conflict of interest. We do not actually operationalize, as the rest of the world does, the ability to handle conflict well. Remember that there's a difference between declaring an interest and having a conflict of interest. And frequently we conflate the two. And frequently I've heard from very senior people that, well, you may say that I have a conflict of interest, but I'm the expert in the area, so it's impossible for the committee to make a reasonable judgment if I am not part of the panel. Right?
Right.
Once you have that kind of a mindset, there is no question that you are not operating according to global norms where conflict is concerned. So whether it is a question of nepotism, favoritism, you know, call it what you will, it is really conflict of interest that we are not dealing with well. And this needs to change.
Bhakti, there, would you want to add to this point? As someone who's getting into the system, what are your views on that? I can't hear Bhakti. Spooti, maybe.
She has to unmute.
Bhakti, can you unmute yourself?
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, now
yes.
You are.
Yes. So, Bhakti, if you want to add to the last question that I had. So the question was basically about nepotism and inbreeding affecting the output.
I'm trying to unmute, but I'm not able to.
Okay. So maybe in the interest of time, we move on. We'll figure out what's the issue, Bhakti, with your connectivity. But maybe, Spurti, if you can take the next question.
Audible?
Yes. I'll switch gears a little bit. This was a great topic that we touched upon, and sometimes like the hornet's nest. I'll switch gears a little bit here and, you know, pose it to start with Dr. Kang again. What do you think would be the key performance indicators of R&D in the country? And how do you think we should be building a framework that quantifies all the wonderful research that happens, but also tracks the participation of various stakeholders who are critical to this research ecosystem?
So that's a really tough question. You know, I think the most important part of having a system that delivers is designing the right metrics for it. So far we've gone with number of PhDs produced, number of projects funded, number of papers written. Is the paper in an impact factor above X? But that does not measure impact. And I've been part of a committee that is set up for the STIP. And one of the things that was brought up as a metric was the idea that can we measure trajectories towards lowering dependence on imported equipment, reagents, etc. Now that's a metric for technology innovation, and I think it's a very useful metric, because that tells you how much self-sufficiency you have. But then I think it needs to have with that an element of quality. So if you were to think about an academic setup, how would you design a metric that showed you that you were doing well? There are many ways of thinking about it. Do you actually attract foreign students and foreign postdocs? Why would people choose to come to you? They would come if you were a world leader for a certain field of research. So if you can do that, if you can compete internationally for funding, not nationally, would that be a metric that would be appropriate? No, not in a special call, but in something that is open to the entire world. I think those are the kinds of measurements that we should have that will show us that we are on the right track. Once again, this is not something that we can have overnight for every field, but if we start with a few indicators for a few fields, we can then look at building on that.
Thank you, Professor Kang. I just want to also, hear Professor Singh's input here, because he also deals with a lot of quantitative analysis of research that's happening in India. So, Professor Singh, do you have any inputs on how we could develop such a framework?
Well, Spurti, it's a very tricky business, designing matrix, and you know, you're never foolproof. You're never, so anything that you, any quantity that you want to measure, you know, you're at least reducing some, you know, some part of it. So, and something as complex as a research ecosystem or a research environment, or you know, how conducive it is to do research in a particular country or an institution, to measure that, it's a huge challenge. What I would say is, you know, of course we should be looking at, so what I see research as is, when we say we do research, it's very important, and particularly for a country like India, is that we are both, we are nationally relevant and we are globally competitive. So when we say we are globally competitive, we of course have to look at indices and indicators and metrics which are there, which compare rest of the world, rest of the countries. For example, OECD has, you know, a lot of indicators. Bibliometrics as a discipline has, you know, a lot of indicators. We measure by total quantities, whether it's patents or out or research papers or so on. Then we do some size normalization. We say, okay, what is the per capita output? What is the per dollar spent output? So there are few indicators in place, but you know, these are all very, very crude. So if we look at a metric and it's you know, I don't see that we would be able to figure out a metric which is, you know, something as good as measuring what we have in India, and something which could effectively 100% capture the overall setting that we have when we say we need to be nationally relevant. So the research output that we produce, the research that we do in institutions, not necessarily in universities, but even in CSIR labs, in, you know, in DRDO labs, in different private organizations. So what we need to do is, we need to be connected to the society. We need to be relevant to the problems that we have. So something may be important for us to answer, to address, but it may not be important for others. So it is very important. So that is where I see there's a scope for indicators and metrics, where you're doing something which is different from what the rest of the world is doing. So otherwise, I would say, you know, if we have to be globally competitive, there are well-established indicators, metrics, norms. We have to be evaluating ourselves on that as well if we talk about indicators.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Singh. So any last comments, Professor Ali, on, we have a question from a viewer as well. Sara Iqbal is asking about, you know, what would be the some of the key attributes of a successful R&D ecosystem? So do you have thoughts, Professor Ali? On this?
You see, if this is the question, the answer is that how many R&D organizations in the country have thought along the line that we are talking about? How often, for example, they invite the student from the university setup, or for that matter, even from the institution, that, hey, guys, you come and work in our setup for about 3 months or 6 months and so on and so forth. This is something that we have not been doing frequently. Once in a while, yes, but it's not something that we do on a routine basis. And number two, R&D as such is not the only thing that we should focus on. Why? Because the real R&D is in the university premises. You see, Oxford is not the place that you can say purely R&D, but yes, great ideas. They're 900 years old history. They don't allow their land to be there. What I'm trying to say is that we have to create overall ambience which must be fully academically charged. When this happens, people automatically get motivated, which is not quite seen in several parts of the country, in so many institutions, in organizations. And a student's viewpoint should also be taken into consideration, because these days students very keenly observe, they do research and R&D on us. And if they find that I'm good for nothing, they dump and move out of your lab. But instead of realizing this nitty-gritty, what we do, we don't even provide them a good reco because the student opposed me. When do we learn to live in real world and not in fool's paradise? I know this because I've experienced this. In my own department, I have to deal with faculty member. They are the one, they should change. And when we all change and dislodge our preconceived notion, things will start happening. Second point that is very important, even in R&D, let me ask a question to all of you. Why is it that, as Professor Kang has rightly mentioned, we are not at all self-sufficient with respect to fine chemicals or even routine chemicals or even, for that matter, equipment that we use in the laboratory, although we have electronic engineers, we have people, they can write algorithms, they can make apps and all these things. They can speak, of course, power of eloquence that they have been gifted. But the point is, we still import. Who is going to fix this problem? Obviously, we have not created an environment where engineers are given free hand to innovate and come out with something which is going to be used in the country, within the country. So Make in India is an opportunity which comes from government side that should be part of also our agenda. Depending upon the skills and expertise, we should engage people and let them flourish. Over to Smurti.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Ali, for your wonderful remarks. I just want to add, invite Bhakti here to, I think she's the youngest of the panelists, who's probably on the other side of the fence, so where she's actually doing active research, perhaps, in terms of, facing these challenges that everybody spoke about. So, Bhakti, do you want to add in anything here to this discussion? Okay, Bhakti, you're on mute in case you are speaking.
She has to unmute. Yeah.
Audible now?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
So I think I agree with Professor Ali on quite a few points.
Yes, you are audible. Go on. Please go on.
I missed the question that Smita asked. I have an internet problem on my end. I kind of feel that we, as we compare the institutions and the research, they lack the inspiration, they lack the ethics, they lack the kind of quality that research requires. And I just had a suggestion in mind, if this can be turned into a policy, if you can give sabbatical to scientists at high positions to go and spend 6 months or a few months of their time at institutes where you want to develop infrastructure and improve the scientific outcomes. They can spend time, interact with the students and with the administrative requirements, and then build a framework on how that can be improvised. Am I still audible? I'm not sure.
Yes. Spurti. So that's a great point. And yes, we've some really interesting thoughts that has emerged from the discussion so far. And what I can figure out is that we all seems to be on the same page, adding to the conversation that's happening. So moving on, I guess we'll switch gears a little bit and start talking about the various other spokes that help in running this whole R&D system. And one of the most important spoke, I would say, though I know all of them play equal role, but funding. And that has always been a topic which it's a burning topic. So I guess we would switch gears here and ask a question about the funding system in India. We all know that, in fact, Dr. Singh mentioned that India spends less than 1% of its GDP, about 0.6-0.7% of its GDP on R&D. And there has been a constant demand to increase it, in fact, to 2% or so. So if we can hear from the panelists about what should be done to improve this funding scenario, both in terms of quality and quantity, and so that this whole process of, you know, applying for funding, getting funding becomes seamless, less bureaucratic, and less of a black hole, as is usually seen by the researchers across the country. So maybe Dr. Kang, if you would take this question first, and then Dr. Ali, Dr. Vivek. Dr. Kang? Hello?
Sorry, I was on mute.
That's fine. So Dr. Kang, if you would, you know, take this question on the issues of funding. And what can be done to make it less of a black hole?
So I think I'm in a slightly unusual position here, and maybe my insights would be helpful to anybody in government who's listening in, is that I, through my entire career in the last 20 years, I've tried to avoid getting Indian government funding. Because quite frankly, the paperwork and the hassles is just not worth it. You get a grant of 30 lakhs, and then for the next 20 years, you are asked about the impact of that grant. You are asked about the equipment that you purchased. You probably submit every year three or four reports for grants that ended 5 or even 10 years ago. That's just ridiculous. That is no way for a government to function when it gives out small amounts of money to people.
True.
I'm sure you want to track impact for large programs, especially when you fund it well and you fund it for a long period of time, it makes sense. But for every last little grant, to the amount of time and effort it must be taking people within government to constantly be tracking what has happened to which grant and how much, you know, has been done with it, it's just, it doesn't make sense. It's not worth the investment. You're not going to get a sensible return on it other than numbers. So if you have to think about what you should be doing with funding, I've seen lots of great examples. I've had funding from multiple agencies that give you tranches of funding. So for example, the NIH, if you are a US investigator, this doesn't apply to foreign investigators, you don't make a very detailed budget. You make a budget that comes in blocks of $25,000, and you say how many blocks you want at what point in time. The overall budget will be reviewed by the funding agency, but your budget is not going to cut. It may be queried, and if you answer the queries appropriately, nobody is going to remove anything from your budget. How your grant is going to be assessed is on the spend reports and on the outcomes. So if we were to think about mechanisms like that, rather than the kind of utilization certificate, statement of expenditure, do it until this period, now 2 weeks later, do it again, and then a month later, do it again, that's a waste of effort. This is not what PIs should be doing.
Very true. Very true. Dr. Ali? You are muted, Dr. Ali, so if you can unmute yourself and...
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, please ask the question.
No, so we were just talking about the funding and the mechanisms that can be, or that needs to be changed to make it less of a black, less of a hassle, and a more seamless process.
See, I think I'm so happy that I would like to thank Dr. Kang with all my heart. She mentioned it's not worth writing 20 reports or maybe more in total, and the money that you got from government will continue to chase you. Unfortunately, the people who work as a member of the task force, first of all, on what ground they are chosen to be member of the task force? What is their credibility? What is their track record? I always ask the difficult or dumb question, and I'm very happy about it. And I've seen that people who have absolutely no knowledge, whether domain knowledge or practical knowledge, are dealing at the interpersonal level or even inspiring somebody or playing a role of a mentor for some student. They have nothing in their CV or in their attribute, but they are there and they make the policy decision. Why? The money is to be given to their friends and not to the person who is trying to establish his laboratory, despite the fact the person has got postdoctoral experience and seen the world a little bit, if not much. No. So this has to change. First point. Second point is that in the beginning, as a matter of standard practice, kindly note my words, very kindly, for 5 years, if you induct somebody for 5 years, fund him enough, saturate him, and then at the end of 5 years, ask him, what have you done? And that will decide either he will move on to or he will do something, whatever he wants to do. But for the 5 years, he has to be free from writing grant. This I have experienced. This style of functioning by the leader has worked very well. If you want, I can name the leader, I can name the institute. This is the way to go. Leader must be very large-hearted, king size, not coming on the way, as all of us agree. At the same time, constantly monitoring that whosoever has got innate scientific attribute should be only encouraged to fly high in the open sky.
Right.
And this is what it is.
Right.
Yeah. Go on.
For those remarks. Dr. Vivek, maybe if we, I can switch gears and ask you to comment on, are we as a whole ecosystem ready for evidence-based research funding? I guess this is continuing from Dr. Ali's point. Are we ready for that kind of funding?
Well, you know, I can't agree to anything other than what Dr. Kang and Dr. Ali said. The real problem in India is not only the lack of resources, but the ease of doing science. It's very, very problematic to, you know, to spend the grant, to utilize the grant. And this doesn't come. This problem is not only from the government, from the funding agency, but it also comes from the institutional setup that you're part of. So it is, you know, what I see is that unfortunately, the overall system where we work in, we start with a premise of distrust that the money that is going to be given to a PI, it is going to be misused. So put in so many checks and balances and reports and UCs and AUCs, you know, what eventually happens is this paperwork becomes so important, so much overwhelming that, and I know what many of colleagues in my university, they don't apply for research grants anymore because, you know, they just can't handle the amount of paperwork, the amount of bureaucracy that they have to deal with. It's really, really very, very problematic. So this is, you know, this is an important thing that needs to be done. And there are many, many examples across the world where, you know, things are very simplified, where funding agency gives, you know, a very simplified bulk grant, and then you spend, you are evaluated after let's say 3 years or 4 years or 5 years. This, you know, and not only that, in fact, in many, many, many countries, you get a part of grant as, you know, as a component of your salary as well. So there are many, many examples across the world where funding is being utilized in a particular manner with all the ease that we have. The real problem that we have in Indian setting is this ease is missing. And that is where people who are not doing anything useful out of the grants, they are very successful in, you know, writing the reports, preparing UCs. So what essentially they do is they get the grant, they prepare UCs, they prepare this, and everything looks very smooth. And the funding agency is very happy that we have all the timely UCs. But look at the output. Look at the actual impact, what this grant had. And that is where the problem is. So I think it is very important that we look at this ease of doing science. And unfortunately, the point that you said on, you know, the evidence-based thing, what I see should be done is, you know, some kind of simple digitization and automation where at every step, at Dr. Ali said, at the step where, you know, where you submit an application for a grant, the committee members, the experts, the credentials that they have. So this selection itself has to be performance-based. This selection itself has to be evidence-based. So you start with an evidence-based selection, you do an unfair, unbiased selection, and don't fund everyone, fund only those who are good enough, who could deliver, and then please do not, you know, do not put so much paperwork, have trust in the PI, have trust in the scientists, and don't, you know, force for so many reports, evaluate after 3 years or 5 years. I think that is what is essentially needed in Indian system. And this could be done very simply if you simply, you know, create a digitized setup where you just, you know, let the PI, trust the PI, let him submit the report and just trust that. So that is, you know, that is what is very, very needed.
Thanks, Dr. Vivek, for putting it, you know, very, very comprehensively. So we all agree that your funding, which is considered what the biggest beast, needs to be simplified for the ease of doing science. So I guess I would ask Spurti to take on the next spoke, which is hiring, and Spurti will take the question.
Yes, so we did touch upon a bit about nepotism and, you know, the scene on the hiring arena. Right now we do have, okay, I'll start with Bhakti for this one. So India spends about 1% of its, as a report released by MEA, Ministry of External Affairs, in 2019, a staggering 7,53,000 Indian students across subjects are studying abroad. That's the numbers left from last year. What do you think we should do to retain our in-house developed pool of young researchers like yourself, Bhakti, and give them an opportunity to work independently and produce good science right here in India?
So I think we have a very talented pool of scientists within India. They have a lot of very good technical knowledge. They are smart. But what we do see missing is when they come to the job market, they are lost, quite a bit of them. They don't have the right direction to pursue their goals. And that, I think, is because we don't network enough early on in our careers. We are so focused on publishing papers that we don't go out and meet people in our fields, in other fields, and look at how we can work together. And so people end up working in isolation in their silos, and they don't feel confident enough to bring and take on riskier projects. So I feel the institute also should groom these students early on in incentivizing students to bring in collaborative projects, intern in the industry if possible on a small project to see how things work in the R&D spectrum there, and then learn from both ends of within academia and outside academia to see how R&D is done, and then, you know, acquire the best you can from the environments and accordingly have such kind of programs where students can explore enough before choosing, because in academia by default you have to look for a faculty position is ingrained in the Indian students, in the Indian postdocs. We don't venture out and take risks, and I think that risk-taking attitude needs to be enhanced in the Indian scientists a lot more. We try to play safe.
Yes, thanks Bhakti, that's a good perspective. And the related question is to Professor Khan, and I just want to, like, you know, add in here, often our hiring process is limited by age. We say, okay, 35 years, this is the, you know, maximum age for you to apply for a position, and then that doesn't really just stop at, you know, applying for a position. It also has implications on the grants that you apply for, the awards that you are nominated for, the fellowships, workshops, name it, and there is a particular age criteria in most of them. So Professor Kang, we are in the 21st century. We do have people who take academia breaks from academia, get into industry, come back, do their PhDs, or, you know, do their postdocs and everything. Do you think at this time and age is a factor at all?
I think we should be looking at what age people produce really groundbreaking work. this whole idea of you are past your sell by date or your start by date at a certain age makes no sense at all. There is no reason why women who have been out of the workforce and want to come back at the age of 40 and be start at assistant prof level or do a postdoc should not do it. If you want to change fields, obviously you would do that at a later stage in your career. I don't think there should be any particular start date. I don't think there should be any particular stop date. If you're productive and you have enthusiasm for science, I see no reason why you cannot continue to work.
Thanks, Professor Kang, for that. I was looking at Professor Vivek nodding his head when I brought this up. So Professor Vivek, do you want to add something to this discussion here?
Well, just a small point that I would like to add is, you know, well, I don't agree at all with this entire, you know, age brackets and saying somebody, you know, you're young, you can do science, you're not young enough to do science. So I don't at all agree with this. And this is very true for particularly for women and, you know, with the career breaks that, you know, most, so a lot of my colleagues had career breaks and then, you know, when they want to come back, there are so many problems with age limits and it's really problematic. What I also would like to add here is the point that you said, you know, where people from, you know, industry coming to universities, people from different setups, you know, after a point of time there. So this cross-fertilization is very useful, is very important. And, you know, unfortunately, you know, these age barriers, they're very, very problematic. So in fact, you know, something has to be done where, so as far as I know, university positions, we don't have this kind of age. So if you want to become an assistant professor or an associate professor, or a professor, I don't think there's an age limit. You could be an assistant professor even at 55 or 60 or something like that. Till 55, at least, that is what I know. But there are many institutions where there are age limits, there are grants where there are age limits. Then, you know, so this is something that has to be done away with. You know, we're not in an era where we should be doing all this. And, you know, taking into account the longevity that we have in our lives, one has to be productive for a longer time.
Dr. Ali, would you want to add to the discussion of age? Dr. Ali, I guess you are muted.
I said, fortunately or unfortunately, I have very practical experience about it. When I learned ABCD of science, I was told to move out. Move out high and dry. Leaving my lab behind, close to about 5 crore rupees worth equipment, and every equipment was managed by my personal grant in the institute. So I follow Gita, Karmane Madhikaraste Mahaphalesu Adachana, Kadachana. I moved out without having any attachment with the lab, and I moved out, and in new place, I established another lab, and then again, I am going to be asked to leave and move out. What I am saying, if a person is enjoying good health and is reasonably productive, able to inspire a student, manage his research, he should be allowed to work. Don't humiliate him because he is not going to say many things to the government or to funding body, but he will surely say to his young son, don't go for science, opt for humanities, don't do science, don't be a scientist. And this is exactly what I want to share with you all. I don't believe in age. I believe that with the passage of time, a person becomes more knowledgeable, more meticulous, more articulated, and he also developed empathy. He also developed compassion. He also becomes more kind-hearted, large-hearted, and in other words, he's better for this society and for the system. That system, unfortunately, has not acknowledged and has not identified. That's one point. Second point, let me also share with you. When it comes to induction and then comes to promotion, many people who are working in the institute as well as in the university system, they are highly frustrated. Why? because the other person, good for nothing, he's given plum position, he's made head of the department, director, dean, and so on and so forth. The other person, more competent, he's kept aside. Why? Junior, only 2 years back he has joined. Right. This has to go. This has to go because university has also done maximum damage to the education system and to the student and to some of those poor faculty members who are not part of the network because of their intellectual bandwidth is very broad, but their social bandwidth is very narrow. And this has to stop because the system has to be made glaringly attractive so that people come and work. And when they enter into their university premises or in the institute premises, they should say, wow, this is the temple of my desire. This is my karma bhumi. And in the evening they want to go, they should say, no, this is no time. I would spend in the lab talking to my student, then I'll go to my residence. And this scenario, this ambience is absolutely required. The current situation warrants us to, again, change ourselves and develop very, very healthy attitude, not only for our own goal, for our own sake, but also for the society and for the country at large. Over to Smita.
Prakriti, thanks. I guess we all agree that age across the whole spectrum needs to be reworked. And again, the merit is something, merit and productivity is something that has to be given preference. So I guess here I would take a question from one of our viewers, Dr. Asad Sahir. And this is about the topic we were just discussing about recruitment. So his question is, recruiting faculty on tenure track is a favorite, but how about recruiting a tenure track junior registrar? It's a little different, but it's about the hiring. Dr. Vivek, would you want to take this question first?
Well, I am not very much aware of, this kind of tenure track junior registrar or something. What I understand is, in academic institutions, we have two kind of staff. You have faculty members, teaching staff, and then you have some support staff, which is not teaching staff. But in many universities, unfortunately, what is happening is the bureaucracy becomes so important. And, there are problems with the bureaucracy and they start controlling. And then there's some kind of, clash with faculty members and bureaucracy. So perhaps what I could understand is that the question is some way related to that. But what I think is, at least in terms of recruiting faculty, there should be no age limit should be there. And as a faculty member, as somebody in academia, you always feel young. And the best part of being in academics is, you are 60, you're 55, you're 65, you're 70, you always feel young because you have young students with you, you have young minds with you, you have, wonderful ideas coming out. And that is where academics is different from others.
Right, right. Over to Spurti.
Yes, so switching gears a little bit again, and this is again something that people already spoke on the panel. Women in science, women who take breaks getting back into science. So something that has been in the talks for quite some time now. I would like to start and ask this to the two women on the panel first. So maybe Professor Kang can go first and maybe Bhakti can add on to this. How do women scientists who often take a break during the initial years due to family reasons continue to play a much more productive role in R&D ecosystem of the country? What are some of the much needed initiatives towards this? Thoughts, Dr. Kang?
So at the time that I had my children, we got 8 weeks of maternity leave. So they were abandoned pretty early in well, I had the advantage of living on campus, so I could get back at lunchtime. But I think because we had hard times before is not a reason to put other people through hard times. So I'm really happy about what is provided from the government now which is 6 months of maternity leave and the opportunity for additional childcare leave. For some people, given their circumstances, that is insufficient. They cannot necessarily find the kind of quality childcare that they want, and they want to take a longer break at the time. I'm not sure that, you know, the government has established many programs that are intended to help women to get back into the workforce. I'm not sure that there has been an impact assessment of those programs to see whether women who came in through getting funding in those endeavors actually wound up in academia and staying in research for the rest of their careers. I think it certainly is a metric that we should track, and we should look at modifying the approach if we find that it is not working. What I've seen in other scientific systems is a level of flexibility that in theory India matches, but in practice that doesn't happen. What really happens in India is that women who take, a lot depends on your boss. If you have somebody over you who is encouraging, who says, you know, take all the time you need, we can be completely flexible about your working career, you will wind up being as productive as anybody else, or less productive for a few years and then super productive after that. But if you have bosses who don't really understand what you go through in terms of family commitments, then that really drags you down. It makes life very difficult. It makes women quit science. And that is a huge loss. If you just look at the numbers, that's where the maximum attrition is happening, in women who have started to have children and don't know how they can handle all their multiple responsibilities. And that's where the onus is on leadership. You need to make sure, we need to make sure that there is a supportive environment. I hope I'm doing that.
Thank you, Dr. Kang, for those insights and also for those comments to, you know, really stress as to why that support is definitely required for people to come and shine at any point in their time. So, Bhakti, did you have anything to add before I go to Professor Ali, who is also in a leadership position, and have his say on this?
I think Professor Kang summed up pretty well most of the points that I had in mind. And also, since there is that, you know, we are typically in that time frame of having children and being recruited for faculty positions, and as most faculty hiring looks at the number of kind of projects you've done and what you have to offer. And so I think it's more valuable to assess women about the kind of projects they're invested in, what their long-term prospects can be, and how well they can offer it, considering you could, you know, have them list out their vision towards those goals and see how clearly they have thought about these issues, and then assess these women in a different way, because you can't always have them compete at all levels with the other candidates at all times. So, I mean, there has to be some variation in assessment for women who've taken breaks to some extent. And I'm sure that's a little ambiguous, but that can be worked out.
Sure. Professor Ali, do you have thoughts about this? How can leadership be the support that Professor Kang talked about? And generally, how should Indian R&D ecosystem support women who want to get into science and want to thrive here?
Yes, I would very much like to share two things. What Professor Kang has mentioned is absolutely true, and she has echoed our sentiment very well. You see, women should not only be respected, but they should be made to realize that they are respected. One point. Second point is that many a time I have seen in many institutions and universities, the moment a female candidate walks into the chamber for interview, the whole so-called male-dominating society in the room starts having a change in their chemistry. This is unfortunate because they don't apparently trust the women. Now, I come to the main point. 90% of my students out of 26 PhD, or maybe 95%, were girls students. They did exceptionally well. They all had faith in my so-called leadership, and I have 110% faith and trust in them. I noticed that compared to boys, the girls are more focused. They mean business, and in the process, they also became very ambitious. So what I am trying to say is that we have to change our mind setup. And as far as women's welfare is concerned, we have to go a little extra mile to ensure that they get what they need if they want to support their family, at the same time want to pursue their research career or teaching. We should be very accommodative. After all, they are mother of children also, and these children are very much part of the society and future of the country. So those of us who are at a position that they can do even a bit for the women, for the girls, we should do that. Don't ask dumb question, why is it that they come to the lab 1 hour late today? Even if they are launching satellite, the satellite can wait, but the poor women cannot wait because she has to take care of the children. When we have healthy attitude, come on, society becomes healthy, country becomes healthy, atmosphere is automatically, you know, becomes very positive. As we sow, so we reap. Women have 200 million additional sequences in their genome. With due respect to men, I would say, genetically speaking, women are superior, and not superior because I am saying superior because God has given them extra genetic material. They are more tolerant, and therefore we should trust women. We should encourage them. We should ensure that they feel happy, protected, as well as they have their own way, and let them function. Allow them to move on and fly as much as they can. Parvaz hai dono ki isi ek jahan mein, kargas ka jahan aur hai shahi ka jahan aur. Should I translate this? The vulture and falcon, they both have same sky to fly, but vulture never flies as high as the falcon. So we have to provide a trajectory or a ground or ambiance or a situation where all the women candidates also can fly like falcon. And that's my very strong comment. Please, over to Smita.
Thanks, Dr. Ali. I guess with the changing time, I would say that no longer women are or should be called poor women because they have to take care of the children, because I feel it's now it's the equal responsibility of both male and the female, both the parents, to change and look after kids and household responsibilities. And I guess that change is happening, and the ecosystem also needs to support that change. So with that, I guess we would move on to because this topic again is very broad, and very important. We can continue, but again, in looking at the clock ticking, we need to move on. And maybe before I take the last question on our different spokes that we have been talking about, this is about human resource, one of the again most critical aspect which we have been talking throughout of the whole R&D ecosystem. How do we make our R&D ecosystem lucrative with job security and competitive salaries for newcomers who we all agree that they prefer professional paths that are away from core R&D? So how can we bring in that change so that the youngsters start naturally gravitating towards the core R&D setup? Dr. Vivek, who do you want to take first?
Well, thank you, Smita. I think what I would see is, being somebody in computer science, when I graduated, I had an option to go for a multinational job, and it was a time where, dollars were like anything. So I think out of my 28 batchmates, 26 of them are United States with BMWs, with big houses and so on. So what I would like to say here is that, perhaps academics is a matter of choice. So, it's like somebody has the flavor and others may not have. So, given this, I don't think that, money is the only driving force that could bring in the right kind of people in academic setting. Of course, academics could never match the salaries and the perks and, the things that you get in multinational companies and private sector companies. But still, this should be, sufficient enough that one can survive. And what is more important is the right kind of environment where whatever passion that you want to pursue, whatever you want to contribute in terms of your interests, your desires to work for science, that gets, the right kind of environment. So if you have the conducive environment, that is perhaps more important, that people, that talented people are retained. They don't think of, whether they have made a mistake by joining an academic institution. So it is more important to have the right kind of environment. I don't see that salaries are so lucrative thing or so important thing for somebody in taking a call whether to be an academic or not.
Agree. Bhakti, would you want to add here?
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. So can you repeat the question? I lost you a little in between.
So this question was basically about making academia more lucrative and more competitive so that, students who are, let's say, interested gets into it without worrying about more professional opportunities. Because that's one major issue that we are facing of not getting good students in academia. So what can be done about that?
So I think a lot of the issues also come down to the publish or perish question that a lot of our generation especially face because of the competition that we have. I'm sure some of the institutes ignore this, but most of the institutes within India look at the number of papers you've published and what impact factor you have. Regardless of the quality or the outcomes or the usefulness of the research. So I think to encourage the younger scientists in academia, I think the way you assess these young scientists needs to change and look at how well they are addressing pertinent questions, relevant questions in science, and how well are they doing it, and are they following the ethics and quality desired, regardless of the impact factors and the number of publications. And if you can provide an environment where such people can thrive, I think people will be attracted to academia. And as Dr. Vivek said, it's not about the salaries or the incentives financially. It's more about the passion. And the passion is towards working quality-wise. So if that is not entertained, but the quantity is entertained, then I think a lot of the younger ones who have to enter academia get disheartened in the process.
Right. I guess well said, Bhakti. And here, maybe I would like to add here that the whole R&D ecosystem, the whole academic system also needs to open up to showcase the amazing science that's happening so that maybe the youngsters get naturally inclined towards, taking some of their passions. So with that note, maybe I would hand it over to Spurti. We have lots of questions coming in from the audience. who's been watching yes. us. We have taken few questions already, but there are still lots of questions. Maybe these would be little, you know, not in sync with each other, but over to you, Spurti.
Yes, so I think you left there with a good, you know, connecting thread there, Smita, talking about the upcoming areas of research and the new normal that we are living in since March has been, you know, living ourselves and grasping to what we have faced as a pandemic, the COVID-19 scenario. So the question there I have right now is from Divya, Singh, and she is asking, how do we prioritize R&D areas in post-COVID condition or post-COVID India in the light of focusing on areas which are of national importance? And do we need a central body to track such an implementation? Are there any particular suggestions by our panelists? Maybe we start with Professor Khan. Professor Kang, you're not audible.
Yeah, no, it's just because I'm stumped by Divya's question. It's a complicated answer, and I'm not sure that just coming up with an off-the-cuff remark would help. It's something where you need to look at the structures and then think through how you would want to respond. I'm sorry, I'm not being very helpful, but maybe Divya could reach out to me on email or something, and we can talk about it.
Yeah, definitely. Does anybody have any thoughts on this question? Giving it a minute and then we move on.
Chair Ali.
Yes, Professor Ali, go ahead.
Should I? See,
yes, sure.
It's a very simple thing. The question may be apparently difficult, but it's a very simple question and therefore simple answer. What is there in the present scenario that our country need most urgently? And the answer is health care system, full stop. What is the second thing that our country needs most urgently? That is education system, whether online or offline. We have to take care of that. What is there that our country needs immediately, urgently, to ensure that we are able to continue? That is communication system. What is most important? Next point is our defense system. And why am I saying is because our country today is sitting at the crossroad. We don't necessarily have to see only in the science and technology and innovation. We have to see the entire environment around our country also. So I think health is very important because of COVID and because of our poor infrastructure, let us call it. Forget about, I'm not going to say and repeat same thing, that far-flung areas, there is nothing. And education, of course, it has to be given 360-degree turn to be able to refocus and readjust its trajectory. And of course, communication and then defense. And then comes other things. Chandrayaan can wait for a week or so, but we cannot possibly wait for a week for our health system. So this is the answer. I think if you pose more questions, I'm prepared to try making an attempt at least to answer your question. Over to Spurti.
Thanks, Professor Ali. Deviating a little bit, and since we are here for STIP 2020, which is about, you know, driving a nice science, technology, and innovation policy for the country, there's a question from Dr. Rimchim Agarwal. Is there any research and industrial collab? Is there a possibility that there was a research and industrial collaboration that can be promoted at a policy level? So if we were to promote research and industrial collaboration at a policy level, how would it look like? Professor Singh, do you want to take this?
Well, Spurti, a very important thing. And, you know, perhaps this is something that we should have to look very strongly. If you look at, you know, just looking at the numbers, we know the total research output that we produce, only about 1.2 to 1.3% is the research output that involves some kind of university-industry interaction. So the problem here is, you know, university is is doing research in its own, industry is doing in its own, government labs are doing on their own. So what we essentially miss, and which is there present in many other countries, particularly, you know, West, is that this dialogue, this interaction that is there between university and industry, it's very important. In fact, you know, the triple helix model of university, industry, government interactions is well recognized. Everybody knows how important it is. But unfortunately, somehow in India, it's not working. And, you know, for a time, I know of a setup where, for example, CSIR labs, there was a system where anybody who want to work for a PhD degree could work at a CSIR lab, but has to be registered in a university. So that is how I know of, you know, many people who you know, initiated some kind of collaboration with the CSIR lab. But with CSIR converting into ACSIR, now they can enroll their students, they can award degrees. So even that interconnection is gone. So what is missing here is, you know, university-industry collaboration is very important, because that is where the research is going to be translated into actual useful products for the society. So this science society connect essentially needs university-industry interaction.
Right. Can I take the next question? Yeah. So yes. This question is from Manu Awasthi. And this is for you, Dr. Kang. This is basically more of a mentoring question. What would your advice be to early career researchers coming into the ecosystem on how to do well, given the constraints which we have been talking about specific to the Indian system?
I think learning, I think learning from people who've been successful within the ecosystem is one way to go. If you can get them to mentor you, and you know, I'm a huge advocate for formal mentoring. We don't do enough of it, and I think we should. If you look at some of the things that the India Alliance is trying to do, they are trying to offer some levels of mentoring, but we haven't reached the stage where it is a formal arrangement that is encouraged by institutions with the goal of helping the career growth of young people. And to be that selfless is something that our senior leadership very rarely understands and implements. So in the absence of having a formal mentoring program, I think for young people to look at what constitutes success for them in their system, who's achieved it, how did they get there, would be very useful case studies. We are determined by our environments, and figuring out what leads to success in the environment is very important. The other thing I will say is start networking as early as possible. You're going to need the young people who are around you to help you with their expertise, with their personal support, you know, professionally and personally. You need to have a support system. And the earlier you establish that, the stronger it becomes, the better off you will be.
Good. Thanks, Dr. Kang. There's a similar kind of question again by Manu Awasthi, and this is for Bhakti. So Bhakti, he's asking you to share your thoughts as an early career researcher on what you would like changed in the ecosystem to help you do the best possible research that you can do. I know we have talked a lot about the issues that are existing in the system, but if you would like to sum it up in terms of what changes you would want to see?
Thank you for that question, because I don't see enough interdisciplinary research within India. I come from an interdisciplinary background, and I struggle to find people I can work with the right mindset. And a lot of people get used to working in their expertise, in their domains, and don't want to come out of their comfort zones and collaborate with people on a completely different topic but on very interesting projects. And I think that needs to change, you know, the physics, chemistry, biology mindset that we have even while recruiting. When you look at the forms online, you have to choose a department to apply. I kind of feel that this constrains the ideas and the projects that you have. So there needs to be a lot of interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary thought and mindset in the hiring process, and having young scientists think beyond their domains of how they can build interesting ideas with people beyond, you know, from through your expertise. So that's what I feel is required if we need our R&D to survive. We can't just, you know, work in our own expert domains all throughout.
Thanks. I guess that again makes complete sense. So with that, we are actually kind of running out of time now. So before we end, I guess I would like all the panelists to sum up their thoughts, the discussions that we've had, and the major changes that you would want or things to get incorporated in the policy. To sum it up in like a minute each, that would be useful. So I guess anyone can go first. There's no orders here.
So I'll go first.
Yes.
There is no end to challenges. But if you really look and don't focus on complaining, look for opportunities, you will find them. Look also for support, and that support may not necessarily be in your department, your institution. But again, you will find people who are willing to support you if they believe what you are doing is important. Working together is a strength, and the sooner that we understand that we lose nothing and gain a lot by working with others, the better off we will be.
Thanks. Wonderful. Dr. Vivek?
Just 3 points that I would like to share again and sum up is, one is perhaps we need to try with, you know, some non-conventional methods. New out-of-the-box thinking is needed. For example, you know, just about women in women's, you know, easing it for women scientists, for women academicians. I would, you know, if I would be the decision maker, I would be very happy to provide for work from home kind of practices, even academic institutions, even, you know, in research labs. So this is one, we have to think like that. Number two, you know, we should promote multidisciplinary universities because, you know, being in a multidisciplinary university is like a real blessing. You are interested in anything, you have somebody to talk to. And, you know, I personally feel it being in Banaras Hindu University where, you know, you have all the disciplines possible from Jyotish to arts to humanities, you know, whatever you name. It's a wonderful thing to be because that really opens you up like anything and it gives you a feel of, you know, where the society is, what the real problems are, what is happening in villages, what is it that can impact in terms of research, how it is impacting economy, society, and so on. And third thing that I would say is, other than resources for doing science, what we need to focus more on ease of doing science, because, you know, this is very important for us to prosper, to grow. And unless we have the right kind of environment, performance-based, you know, performance-based mechanisms, evidence-based mechanisms, it's going to be very difficult for us to you know, to be a leading player in R&D ecosystem.
Thank you, Dr. Vivek. Bhakti?
I think in my limited experience, perseverance and trying plays a big role. There are a lot of failures, there are a lot of setbacks. You may have visioned a year or two to complete a project, but it took 4 years, 5 years. But I think it shouldn't defeat the purpose of doing the research that you wanted to always do. And don't get disheartened. Keep trying. You know, some door may open up, I feel. I have hope.
Be hopeful. Dr. Ali?
Yes. Two things I would like to tell the students who are going to start science career. Before you begin your research, conduct your research for 15 days or 1 month on the so-called supervisor that you are going to join. Even if he publishes very high quality paper, but if he is going to make your life miserable in the lab, don't ever join him. Do find out these nitty-gritty, these details, and having a very healthy atmosphere in the lab will go a long way to mold your career and to ensure your productivity and your overall prosperity. Second point, even if you publish paper in the beginning, which is not in so-called high impact factor, doesn't matter. There is always something like second day, second time, second chance. So while failures are the pillar of success, you don't have to design an experiment to be flop, show and failure, but having hopes is something which will continue to motivate. And you must know, I give a lot of importance to the freedom of student. And this experiment that I have done has been extremely successful. Today, I'm a very satisfied person and extremely grateful to God Almighty. So my student, dear student, if you are listening to me, have faith in divine forces, but choose the right person for your research work and make sure within about 4 or 5 years, you are able to come out of the lab, because those, doesn't matter how many papers they make you publish, if they take 12 years for your PhD, it's no good. Your actual research also starts after your PhD when you join any lab as a postdoctoral fellow. I hope you meet with decent soul to be able to craft and chisel out your career. All the very best.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ali. I guess on that note, I would hand it over to Spurti. Thank you, all the panelists. Thank you, all the viewers, for being there, for sharing your thoughts. These are really diverse. I wish we could have spent a little more time on each of them, but considering the time, I guess this is what best we could do. So thank you once again to everyone, and over to you, Spurti.
Yes, we have come to an end of what was a fantastic session, a discussion that I think a lot of people have had different perspectives and insights. We're very grateful to everyone for your participation. Of course, our panelists who shared with us their insights and perspectives, and also to our audience who have been so enthusiastic in asking a great set of questions to our panelists today. I would like to thank Smita for her time and steering the discussions that we had today. This event would not have been possible without the hard work of the team that is working behind the scenes. Just a big shout out to Suresh, Dennis, Ashwini, Siddharth, Divya, and Chagun, who have put in enormous efforts to kind of, you know, get people together and talk and have this panel that we are having today. Thank you all. I would also like to thank Gubi Labs, which has partnered with the Science Policy Forum to facilitate this public participation for the task one activities of STIP 2020. With this note, I wish to remind all our viewers that there are more thematic panel discussions happening every single day until the 10th of July. So please refer to the Science Policy Forum website for more details on the themes that we have every day. So there's one tomorrow as well. So you can also tune into our social media handles for more information. Do join us there too. And for now, wish you all a good night and bon appetit for your dinner. Thank you. And before the panelists sign off, I just request you to wait for a minute. We have a group photo. So if you could just turn on your videos.